All right, good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. We are excited about your interest in climate change and the impact that...
Can't hear you.
We're excited about your interest in climate change and the impact and response that Bedford has to that. I'm Erin Dorr. I'm going to be your moderator for the evening. We are excited to host this event with the Energy and Sustainability Committee and Mothers Out Front in Bedford. Michael McDonnell from ESC is here, and he will be talking a bit about what the ESC is all about. And Mothers Out Front, for anyone that doesn't know, is a Cambridge-based organization, nationwide grassroots now, that is fighting for a sustainable climate for our children and their future. So we're run locally by Sue Swanson and Corinne Dowd, and they're very excited about their latest award for the UN Climate Action Network. Michael, you want to talk a little bit about the ESC?
Hi, I'm Michael Donnell, a member of the Energy and Sustainability Committee. It's an advisory committee to the town selectmen. We work on all kinds of projects that are related to increasing the town efficiency, lowering costs of energy, and looking for ways to help out with the climate change. Some of the things we've been working on is the community choice aggregation. You may have seen some mailers that came out. You might have seen your energy bill change just a little bit. We were instrumental in getting that started. And up to the selectmen when they decided to make the change. And currently we're working on a net zero initiative that we'll be learning more about as time goes on. And later I will invite you all to come to any committee meeting that you would like to.
So we have a full event this evening. We will then be transitioning over to our panel of speakers. Michael Griffin is the, now I'm going to take my notes. Okay. Science program administrator for our high schools. He's going to be speaking about the climate impact in Massachusetts. Heidi Porter, who's the director of Health and Human Services for Bedford, is going to be discussing the mosquito and tick surveillance that Bedford is working on now. And Tassira Lani, director of facilities for the town of Bedford, is going to share with us the solar plan and energy plans moving forward. We will then transition to question and answers to the panel, a small breakout session, and then wrap up with some thank yous for the evening. So, Michael, thank you so much for joining us tonight. He's the science program administrator and currently teaches advanced placement environmental science in the high school. He's the environmental club advisor and co-coordinator of the Women of Science competition. Mr. Griffin coaches the Envirothon team and Science Bowl teams, and he serves as Massachusetts Science Ambassador for the Department of Education and has received teaching recognition awards from Harvard, MIT, and Stanford.
Well, thank you for allowing me to talk to you tonight. I usually have a younger audience, so it's nice talking to you guys tonight. I'm giving a shortened presentation of an overall thing about what climate is and some of the effects that we're experiencing in Bedford and in Massachusetts in general. The slides are a conglomeration of a lot of things that I've pulled from a lot of sources. So usually what I like to begin with is talking about climate and what climate actually is. It's not a weather phenomenon, it's a long-term effect, and it usually has to deal with the precipitation and temperature that occur over long time periods and long time spans. And as you can see from the observations in Massachusetts for our temperature increase, pretty much all of the climate models are predicting us to get much warmer than we are right now, even if we stop putting carbon into the atmosphere. Why is climate important? If you think about it right now, in our lifetime and in our children's lifetime, our weather is going to look more like the Florida than it is in Massachusetts. This is a picture of last winter at Beaverbrook in Belmont. Quick plug to my son, if you go out there, just put in a nice tree walk about the history of the trees in there. But as we move and all the climate change is going to occur, it's important that we understand that climate is measured in years, decades, in centennials, and even into the ice age of what was happening. a lot of the conferences and agreements that have gone on worldwide, the U.S. has pulled out of most of them and isn't supporting them right now, which is something hopefully our children, I'll tell you, my students are very angry about, and that we can get more involved with. They have become very involved in the push to do something. So why does climate matter? Well, climate affects all of our soils. It affects what's going to grow. Later on, we'll hear about what it's going to affect to the bugs population and the growing seasons, everything going on. It also is going to be extreme weather events. This is kind of interesting because if you looked at the news this morning, this happened. We have astronomically high tides that are going to be flooding most of our coastal areas. They did just this morning. Watching the news, if you ever go to Long Wharf, that was all flooded by a foot of water, and it wasn't a bad storm, and it wasn't supposed to, but it's going to be a reoccurring event and get worse before it gets better. So what is it we expect in the next couple of years? I always tell my students that, hey, 2050, it's 30 years from now. It's happening a lot quicker. A lot of my students have been sending me the articles about we don't have 30 years, it's going to be 12 years. The predictions are becoming much faster, and things are happening that are just causing our climate to change on a much grander scale than the models even predicted. So if you look at the lower emission and higher emissions as we go through, by 2070, we plan to be as a South Carolina climate, if nothing has changed right now. So what does that mean as far as biome is concerned? We're going to be moving from a temperate deciduous forest closer to a tropical seasonal forest, meaning that we're going to have a rainy season and a dry season. It's not going to be as much as our four seasons that we currently have. We can see some of that slow change happening now. I don't want to say it's completely changed because remember, climate is over longer time periods. But when we get to the end, we'll show you a little scary little fact about that. So warming in Massachusetts, we are warmer. We've been increasing at a rate that's faster than a lot of the areas around here. The general global warming is not the same worldwide. It's more extreme in the northern populations, and in the Northeast, we're going to have a lot of extreme changes that occur. Historically, our hottest summers are going to become our coolest summers. Our coldest winters are going to become our warmest winters. So the projections, all the models that we look at, everything is bleak right now. After presenting this to my students, they say, how can you still teach this stuff? Well, somebody's got to, and we have hope. We can still change. We're the most adaptable people in the world. In the last 10 years, eight have been the most hottest on record globally. So that's trending a lot. They did a poll in Britain where they had an article asking the citizens out there, how many in the last 22 years, how many were the hottest on record? Most people said about 12 to 15. Turns out 20 of the last 22 years in Britain were hottest on record for the area. Surface temperature changes, as you can see, all the models predicting it are going hotter and warmer all the time. And as the changes occur, we're going to have a hotter summer in extreme heat days. Right now we're predicting to have about 11 days over 90 per year. By 2070, they expect it to be 26 to 90 days of heat over 90 degrees, with possibly 33 days over 100 degrees each year. Now, these are models, and things change, which is why we say we're predicting it, but we base it on all the models seem to be coming true right now. Rain and snow, believe it or not, we have more rain than we ever had, more precipitation, but why do we have a drought? Because our rain is more extreme. It comes down harder, and it's not soaking into the soil, it's just running off, causing the floods, running off into the ocean and into our streams and everything. So even though we are having more rain, the rain that we're having is not the rain that regenerates our groundwater and goes into the areas we had. I'm happy we're having this long, gentle rain right now, because that's the kind that we used to have a long time ago, but it's becoming a rarer event as we move on through the time. Just in general, we know this should be an easy slide. The CO2 in the atmosphere, why is it so important to reduce carbon dioxide rather than, not many people talk about methane and the nitrous oxides that are also greenhouse gases, but it's the carbon dioxide that retains in the atmosphere for the longest time, and it's going to cause that long-term warming. We're already over 400 parts per billion in the atmosphere. And we know this started in the Industrial Revolution. We look at the ice cores, and that's when we really started to burn everything. That's when the temperatures started to accelerate, which is why we can say that it is man-related. There are people, there are other things that can affect the climate that we talk about, but these are the different sources of greenhouse gases that we have in the atmosphere. This is really tough, sorry.
Yeah.
So you can see electricity and heat that we have, that's not the electricity in the households, that's the electricity and the heat that we generate to run everything in our households from the big power plants. That's where most of it comes from. One thing that's not indicated up in the map up here that doesn't get a lot of press is the production of cement. Cement produces a lot of greenhouse gases in production, and it's not the thing that we can, you know, put out there on posters because people don't understand it too much, but reducing the amount of cement that we produce or looking at different products that can reduce the carbon emissions from cement production would greatly go into keeping the level of emissions down. Why is it so cold sometimes? We've heard of the polar vortex. Remember this from last year? Well, the reason why the polar vortex is important is because under normal conditions, the extreme difference in temperature between the pole and the rest of the world allows this polar vortex to stay and trap the cold in the northern climates. Because the poles are warming so much, it weakens and causes a less of a temperature difference between the area, and that's what's allowing the cold air to dip down into the continental U.S. and into all the continents. It pushes it down lower. Has it occurred in the past? Yes, but usually it occurs for a couple days and then drops back up. They're starting to think that this is going to occur more and more and last for longer time as it weakens. So at some point in February or something, I predict that we're going to have an extreme cold for about 5 or 6 days, hopefully not like Chicago had last year, which is up to about 2 weeks for extreme cold that just dipped down. Your beachfront property, I had to laugh about this picture on the bottom. This is from last year. It could have been from the news this morning. That's how it flooded on Long Wharf. It was a little bit higher this morning, actually, there. This is going to become a recurrent thing. If you look over the Seaport District in the picture over here with the 2 degrees sea level rising, this will become a natural flooding occurrence in the Seaport. They're already planning for it in many areas. The power station that was built over by the World Trade Center area on the end there, they put all the power on the second floor because they're predicting the amount of flooding, and if a storm surge comes in, it's going to wipe out everything in that area. So if you're planning to buy property and stuff, I wouldn't go in that area for right now because it's going to flood eventually, and it's going to become a reoccurrence thing on every tide, every high tide, and especially the astronomical high tides like we're having right now. Tidal flooding, they predict to increase the number of events that we have to be a reoccurring event. By 2070, it should be a daily occurrence almost in a lot of areas. This is an interesting factor that I like to put up, is that a lot of things take into account why global warming could be changing different things. So sun's variation has a lot to do with the sun's output. Also, dust and gases from volcanic eruptions, the dust from fires and stuff that come across, those can also reduce the temperature in local areas a lot. The picture on the bottom was an interesting one that somebody sent to me. It has to deal with the sun's output and the rise and fall of empires. So every time there was a peak in sun output, we had a peak in empires, and then it dropped. Well, we're at a peak right now at the internet age, so who knows? Hopefully not. But it was just kind of, I just found it interesting, that's all. It has nothing to do with climate. But. Why we use models, that's all we can do. Science can't prove anything. We can only show that what we can expect to do. We can prove things wrong. So you can always nitpick, and a lot of climate naysayers will nitpick the small little things, But in general, they're not looking at the big picture and the overall climate models that are there. They're all predicting a much warmer. How much warmer it's going to be depends on us and how much carbon that we put out there. In my teaching, I try and tell the kids live by example. And a lot of them do and start pushing the different events they can do. What you can do as environmentalists, they asked this question in Britain. They gave them a list of a whole bunch of different things that they can do. One of the number one things that they said they could do, what we can expect in Bedford. We're going to be touching on some of this a little bit later. Heat-related illnesses are going to go up, especially on our old and the young. Storm severity definitely increases. Insect-borne diseases, Lyme, Triple-E, and West Nile virus, we're not getting rid of them because they can spread easier and they don't die off. We have not had our first killing frost, so that's why we can't go outside at night. But Lyme disease is also a big one out there that's spreading on a rampant level. Poison ivy is also increasing and spreading. You see it everywhere nowadays. This poison ivy that's in our courtyard that I have a battle with every single year, it's giving me rashes about every other year because I forget about it. And we teach the kids how to do it. Also, the allergy season, if you have allergies, the growing season is already extended by 10 days, which is pushing our allergy season much longer. So those are affected by allergies. That's why it's a little bit more sneezy throughout the year that's going on. Back to the question that they ask. So people say they should recycle as much as possible. That's really kind of low on what you can do. Best thing you can do is have one less kid. I'm not saying don't have one less kid, but it is a choice. Having children is the biggest impact you can have. How many you have definitely impacts the future of the world. Some other things are avoiding becoming a non-meat eater. So three of the biggest things are red meat and dairy is another big thing to avoid because those are all carbon intensive for the production. And then a few things you see listed up there. The answers are in a list that was put in Britain, how they ranked it. And then the actual rank is over on the side. So the number one you said, having one fewer less kid. Another big impact, take one less transatlantic flight a year. And that would have another really big impact on what we can do. All the resources are there that came from. And I was supposed to be short, and hopefully that was it. Quick overview.
Thank you. That was really, really informative. Heidi Porter is up next. Heidi is our Director of Health and Human Services for the town of Bedford. She's been with the town for 8 years now. And in that role, she leads health and youth and family departments and oversees the Council on Aging and the Veterans Association services. She serves as Mosquito Control Commissioner for the town, lucky you, and implements and manages the mosquito control programs and our curfews and as set forth by the Board of Selectmen. Heidi holds a master's in public health from BU and a bachelor's in geology and environmental studies from Tufts. Thank you, Heidi.
Thank you. Hello, thank you for having me tonight. I think I'll stay stationary. We might have a little bit better output here. we're going to talk a little bit, I'll briefly touch on our current programming here in Bedford and surveillance that we do relative to mosquitoes and a little bit about ticks. As we've talked about already tonight, we recognize that climate change is going to impact these aspects of our environment, temperatures and precipitation, both of which mosquitoes and ticks love. Those are great environments for them. Warmer winters are going to contribute to increases in these vector-borne diseases, as indicated, Triple-E, West Nile, and Lyme disease. If there's more water, there's a great environment for these critters to grow in. We know mosquito larvae can grow in a volume of water as small as a bottle cap. So we don't need much. So imagine if all of our wetlands or pools or tarps or water-containing containers are filled with water more regularly and for a longer period of time. Also, ticks enjoy a moist environment. They thrive in it, as a matter of fact, and just dislike heat and sun. So we want to, those increases in those conditions are going to proliferate those issues. As you know, this year we're dealing with a statewide, actually area-wide, Triple-E issue, an outbreak. We typically see Triple-E in a a cycle, a 10 to 20 year cycle. This is a seven, we've had, the last outbreak was 7 years ago. So we're seeing things happen a little bit quicker given conditions are changing environmentally. In Bedford, not only do we have a moderate risk level with regard to the conditions that exist, but we also had a triple E positive mosquito identified in town, which is troubling, obviously, you know, those mosquitoes, and it wasn't a mosquito that's actually considered a bridge vector in that it bites not only birds, but it bites humans, and that's how the disease could potentially be transmitted. So it was as a result of that identification. In addition to, our history in Bedford, we had actually had a human case many, many years ago that many of us remember. And it sits for a long time, and we want to be considerate of that and mindful of that. So we have, indeed, our additional protections in town to ensure our dusk to dawn ban of activities over the evening. And, you know, we recognize, and what we're hearing from the entomologists that study this stuff, is that we saw triple E a little bit earlier this year because our swamps didn't dry out last year. We typically have a drying situation between fall and winter, and our wet areas stayed wetter longer last year, and that allows them, the mosquitoes, the larvae didn't dry out, so they thrived longer, they thrived over winter, and therefore we had a higher population in the spring when the spring waters, spring rains came. So talk a little bit about how we currently control mosquitoes. We are fortunate that we're a member of the East Middlesex Mosquito Control Commission, and we have been, it's a project, and we have actually been members for quite a while. And through that project, we have access to entomologists and biologists that do quite a bit of studying for us and actual control services within the community. The project is great in that it offers a menu of services. Each city and town that's a member can pick and choose what they want to have, which is good from a budgeting perspective. But whereas Bedford has a robust program, some of our neighbors don't have as robust a program, and I guess there's a consideration that mosquitoes don't necessarily know town boundaries, so we're not really working on a regional level here. Additionally, you'll see from the map, although Concord should be listed there, this map needed to be updated, and in my presentation I actually brought it to their attention. So Concord should be on here, but what's noticeable is, and which is considerate of the fact that we had a mosquito up on Winterberry Way, that mosquito pool that tested positive. Carlisle, the town of Carlisle, doesn't participate at all. They do absolutely no mosquito control whatsoever within the community. Neither does Woburn. And this is also, if you look at the map statewide, I wasn't able to find one, but if you look at what areas of cities and towns actually are members of projects that are able to provide surveillance and control, it's quite sporadic. It's not concerted across the entire Commonwealth. So you know, we recognize that as a gap, not only for our own community, we do the best we can here for our own residents, but you know, we need to really have a better program, either with participation by all communities within the Commonwealth, or have the Commonwealth actually take the initiative to provide services across the board, which would be, you know, would be really helpful. So I'll just talk a little bit in detail, about what our program looks like. I'm sorry, my visual there is a little bit skewed, but we start in the springtime with our larva sighting. You may have seen the helicopter or have received the notice that the helicopters have the swath, and this is exactly one of the helicopters that's used. We have the areas within Davis Road, the Cedar Swamp there, the Town Forest and Springsbrook area, a total of just about 233 acres of swampland, wetlands that are treated with the larvicide to control the mosquito population in an attempt to control the mosquito population. Our project, EMCP, will also go into wetlands by foot and treat wetlands that are not as easily accessible. We are fortunate to have the Great Meadows National Wildlife Preserve as a resource nearby, which is a lovely area. It being a federal preserve, they do not allow treatment for mosquitoes in that area, and we recognize, and the project recognizes, that does impact the mosquito population within our community. They do, this year, they were required to implement a mosquito control plan, so we're working with them to ensure that does get implemented. So in a situation like we had this year with a severe, actually if we reached a severe risk level relative to Tripoli, that we would have been able to have the opportunity to get in there to do some larviciding and do some treatment for mosquitoes. The next thing that we do throughout the year is a larviciding. You'll see, may see DPW staff roaming the streets of Bedford, not just observing the lovely roads and sidewalks that they've installed over the past year, but actually treating the catch basins, which is a location where the larvae for West Nile virus will grow. They actually love any sort of urban environment, and they use this. They use the Bacillus ferricus to do the treatment there. We, you know, talk a little bit about the fact that we are using a pesticide in our environment, but that it is indeed has a low toxicity, and it's very specific in its toxicity in that it does impact the larvae, the mosquito larvae themselves. We also do mosquito trapping. We have 5 locations in town, across town, and this is indeed how we found the Tripoli positive pool. It's not just one mosquito, but it's a pool of mosquitoes that are trapped. These are 2 examples of mosquitoes. A mosquito traps, the one on the left is a gravid trap. The one on the right is a light trap. They work in similar ways, but different ways to trap mosquitoes. And the traps are collected, they're set in the evening, they're collected the next day by the entomologist. He has the lovely job of going through and counting the mosquitoes, speciating them, and then crunching them all up and having them tested for disease. He's got a doctorate level degree, and he's dealing with bugs all day, but he loves it, and we're grateful to him for that work that he does. Our trap locations, just for your information, are on Meadowbrook Road, Hayden Lane, Winterberry Way, which is where our positive mosquito pool was found this year, Ledgewood Drive, and Concord Road. And then we have the truck-mounted spraying that's conducted as needed when we get the results back from the traps. We are finding out about mosquito population, so we are cognizant of nuisance mosquitoes and that folks are bothered by mosquitoes, but we're also trying to be respectful of the fact that we want to spray as little pesticide in our environment as possible, and that they follow a very strict plan as far as concentrations that are released, but we're very specific in trying to address when indeed there is a disease-positive mosquito present. Typically for us in Bedford, it's West Nile, and we'll see that in the mosquitoes that are collected more in the catch basins that are more densely populated areas. But unfortunately this year we did indeed have the positive up in West Bedford. Folks in town, just for your information, have the ability to exclude their property from the spraying that may be conducted. And that exclusion process is available on the Board of Health website, so you can check that out if that's something that might be of interest to you. And then in the off season, we still keep our folks busy, and they conduct ditch maintenance services. In Bedford, we reach out to DPW. They seem to have a really good handle on areas that are getting clogged, causing some backups either in culverts or ditches, some of our wet areas, and they're able to coordinate with the Conservation Commission. DPW does that, and working with the project to deploy the excavator to clear out the area so we have more flowing water. We don't have the stagnant water that can perpetuate the growth of the larvae. So moving on a little bit to tick control. So we have a robust mosquito control program and surveillance program. We have a robust tick surveillance program. That's kind of difficult to control ticks townwide. And we've been a member of the Middlesex Tick Task Force, say that 5 times fast, since 2012. And the members are remarkably from Carlisle and Concord and surrounding communities working together to address and prepare outreach materials. We're really trying to get folks to buy into the self-protection, wearing appropriate clothing, wearing bug repellent. You'll see other stuff here that we've done. We've placed some signs at trailheads and done this really great landscape brochure, which talks to and just provides us information. You'll see the barrier that's outlined there for folks to learn how to prepare a barrier from a tick environment within your own yard. It's been shown to be quite effective, a 3-foot barrier between your grassy area and a forested area will prevent the ticks from entering the grassy area. As we discussed earlier, they don't like heat, they don't like sun, they're hesitant to cross, they don't like gravel and wood because it's out in the open, and they're hesitant to cross that area. There's still other vectors that can get them into your yard, like deer and mice, But this is a really good way to prevent a larger population within your area, within your own yard. This year, just last month actually, we had Dr. Sam Telford from Tufts University come to speak at the Board of Health meeting to talk to us a little bit about tick mitigation and some strategies that the town could take on a townwide level to begin to think about actually doing some implementation of some methods to reduce the tick population. And he was in favor of a program that we were putting forward that was we were working on with DPW with regard to installing a tick barrier at one of our town fields. And so indeed we are gonna do that project in the spring with the DPW and determine efficacy. We feel as though we're gonna have a good outcome. We will do some surveys before and after to make a determination on that. But Dr. Telford was quite positive in the fact that it was gonna have a good outcome, but he was indicating that it has to be like a multifaceted approach to tick control. There's so many things that can be done. I mean, in addition to protecting yourself and conducting tick checks on your own person, spraying is not, he's not opposed to the spraying. He's not opposed to thinking about maybe using some tick tubes to provide the pesticide back into the mouse environment. And actually talked a little bit about deer culling, which was kind of an interesting topic and potentially a conversation for the future. And the town of Weston does that on an annual basis. So as far as surveillance goes, we have this great surveillance system within the state. They report to us when a resident from Bedford goes to their doctor or the hospital and is tested for a tick-borne illness or for a mosquito-borne illness, and they test positive for it. We receive that data, so we're able to follow up with the resident to find out where they may have contracted, received the bite, and how they may have, so where they may have been, whether they thought it was at their home or at another location, and how they're doing, and do some follow-up with them relative to that. With the mosquito-borne illness, it's a little bit more specific, but we recognize, and it's actually why I know by many folks, many experts in the field, that the tick-borne illnesses are highly underreported, we think by about tenfold. Tick-borne illness is our second most highest reported communicable disease in town, just behind flu every year, and that's all the tick-borne illnesses together. And so we, typically over the past couple years have had an average of about 36 36 cases. So multiply that by 10, probably about a little over 350 cases annually. And that's because folks will typically go with a bullseye rash or symptoms that are either Lyme related, or the doc will kind of determine that that's what the illness was, or they have had actually know that they had a tick bite and will treat before they actually do any testing. And also the testing is really imperfect at this point in the game still. So we know that we're not getting super data on that, but we are getting some data. The benefit that we have done, and it's remarkable, the state doesn't require follow-up on tick-borne illnesses. They don't really want any, they never ask us to call residents, but we've taken on a new project over the past year where we are calling residents and hoping, and we've actually sent out letters to folks who have been reported to have tick-borne illness. We're trying to gather that data, although it be anecdotal, to determine where we're seeing disease, where folks are getting bitten by the bugs that are causing the disease, and hope that we can maybe do some more that'll help guide us in the future with regard to any sort of mitigation that we might be doing along the lines of the tick barriers or spraying or whatever else that we might choose to do in the future. So that is our program in Bedford. You can see that we have a pretty comprehensive program, recognizing that if we have more water, higher temperatures, if we have more conditions in which are going to allow these critters to grow in larger populations, it's going to be harder to control. It's going to be more services that we're going to require, and some strategies, I think, from our DPW and others in town to think about how we're going to get rid of the water, try to lower the water and remove it, and that it's not staying in place and stagnating for extended periods of time. We'll see how that sort of plays out, but I think we are well positioned in the fact that we do have a very robust program in accepting of a lot of the services that are made available to us. the Board of Health this year, the board themselves, the five-member elected board, sent out a letter to area boards of health and some other colleagues across the state to ask for their support, and if they're not members of a mosquito control project, to join one. Also to ask for support from the state for funding to support all communities to become members of projects so that they can receive mosquito control services, and also to support the Great Woods and the Great Meadows Wildlife Preserve to allow access to that facility to be able to do some treatment in the event that we have another Triple E outbreak. We're in year one of our outbreak with Triple E. It comes, as I said, typically comes in 10 to 20 year cycles. Once it arrives, it's here for 2 to 3 years. So this is year one. It's been a tough one for sure. As you all know, we've had some trying month or so. We had our ban that went into place back in early September, and here we are at the end of October, still contending with that. We haven't seen a frost. We haven't had we've had very warm temperatures. Believe me, I've become an armchair meteorologist in my job in addition to my other duties. So we're hopeful. I hate to wish the bad weather to come, but in this year, I'm kind of ready for it at this point. Thank you.
Thank you, Heidi. And as a mom of a son who contracted Lyme this summer, I appreciate the thoroughness and the preventative measures that you're taking on behalf of the town. So thank you. Next up, we have Tasir Alani. Tasir is the director of the Facilities Department in the town of Bedford. He's been with Bedford since 2014 as the director there. He's got a Bachelor's of Science in Electrical Engineering from Northeastern, a Master's in Facilities Management through Mass Maritime, and he's also a certified facility manager by the International Facilities Management Association, holding various certificates in engineering and operations. He brings forward to Bedford 25 years of experience in the field of engineering design, constructions, and operations, and he is one of our net zero heroes for Bedford. So thank you, Tasir.
Thank you. Ooh, that's not fair. I thought I would go between Mike and Heidi so I can hide, but... So what I thought we could do actually just really go through the history in Bedford of the last few years and what we're currently doing and then what we're really trying to do for the next 5 years as we develop our own 10-year energy program. So this is, I can't see it from here, but so Bedford became a green community in 2012. So the green community status was, it's a green community is a designation given by the state, and to be designated a green community, you have to have achieved 20% of energy savings, or you cut your energy by 20%. So once that was achieved, it was part of the application. Thanks to the former Energy and Sustainability Committee, which was the Energy Task Force. So that was in 2012. I have to give Bedford some credit and say, in fact, the Bedford prior to 2012 and 2009, they started switching from oil to natural gas. So all the boilers in the big schools were changed really from oil to natural gas. So way before the green community, they started doing that. So that's great. So then we'll talk about the energy storage, the proposed building for solar, and the future, the microgrid, and the current and project and the future project. So green community was 2012. You can see over the last few years, the street lights, which facilities really took a leading role into making it happen. We went from the high pressure sodium, the yellow ones that you used to see on the street, to the LEDs. We did the town hall here, the MEP, it's mechanical, electrical, plumbing, or electrical mechanical plumbing. We went from 6 boilers down to 2. We went from 2 zones to about 23 zones here at Town Hall. It used to be really just first floor, one zone, second floor, one zone. So one side of the building is always hot, the other is always cold. We installed various VFDs, which is variable frequency drive, and that's a piece of equipment. It's a mechanical equipment that will work based on demand. So instead of running, say, the fan at one speed, it runs based on really demand for the heat or the cooling. So they save a lot of energy. We did the Davis and Lane energy recovery ventilators. We don't do unit vents in classrooms anymore. We installed energy recovery units on the roofs with heat pumps. We did LEDs at Town Hall and Town Center last summer completely. The high school, JGMS, Davis Lane, all of them. So three of the last four years, we've received over $700,000 in grants from the green community. Last year we had $248,000. This year we just received $185,000. That's what we requested. So we've been receiving really a lot of money just to do energy projects. We also don't really stop at the mechanical equipment. When we do a design, we also make sure the construction materials are actually of sustainability impact. For example, we're using a new type of floor. It's called the QVT versus the VCT, which is the vinyl composite tile. And the new flooring, which we have now at Lane and Davis, does not require waxing every summer. Every summer when our custodians take out all the furniture from the classroom, they have to redo the floor, paint, and do all these things. So the new floor does not really require waxing, which means less chemical materials to use. It also saves us money on overtime and operation because they can do more floors than they used to. We signed an electrical contract with 100% green option, and it took effect July 1, 2019. And we installed some charging stations on our own, and we hope to install more too. They've been really, I see the ones at Town Hall, I follow the report, the Town Hall and the high school, they get used a lot. And they're, at the moment, they're free to use, so use them. This is just an example we presented to the school committee and the selectmen, kind of really an overview of the solar program that we're working on. There is no like final design. This is just really a proposal that we're studying right now. But for example, the high school, you can see, it would have solar rooftop units as well as the energy storage. These are Tesla batteries. And the reason is it would really help us in both aspects of savings. One is operation-wise, we would cut down on the demand charge we pay to the local company, Eversource. And then the other one, we would use it in case of peak demands or in case of power outage, so that the batteries would take over and provide power. We do have emergency generators, but these would also be another source of power for us. So that's just a sample example. You know, why solar and storage? It would really, you know, the solar is just available when the solar is available, when it's sunny and you produce kW. The storage, when you couple that with the storage, then it's available almost any time during the day because we charge the batteries either from the solar during the day or we can charge them at night, which is a lot lower rate than during the day. So that's our goal, is to really go for solar and storage. So this is just, again, things under consideration and we're looking at it. This is Davis. You can see it's both the rooftop units as well as parking lot in case if we go for that. That's a future, you know, proposal. Lane is the same way. We're looking at Lane to maximize the solar as well as the parking. JGMS, and we just did, I think there is a picture actually for the small system that we did. So the current ones, this is just really the pilot we just installed thanks to Mothers Out Front and the program, the Home Energy Assessment Program. We were given a good chunk of the money to pay for this, so that was a sample. We installed 10 solar panels. It's right above where the superintendent's office is on Railroad Ave. You can probably see them, but that's the panels at JGMS. The public, the Bedford Public Library HVAC project, we're in the process of designing this one. Again, if you know the building itself was half from the 1960s, the other half was the new addition. Both sections use different heating and cooling systems, so one side is always hot, one side is really always cold. We're looking at integrating both into one system, and it would be very close to net zero, as we close as we can get. But the whole goal is to really kind of stay away from fossil fuel in the future. So that's our goal. So you'll see a lot of heat pumps and solar and things like that. The police addition, which is being designed again right now, the addition will have the same thing, the new HVAC system and the renovation too. So we, in the town, we have a 6-year capital program. So we're trying to develop a 10-year energy plan for us, but it will be built around the 6-year capital program so that we're not really overwhelming the town with demand and projects. So whenever we have an opportunity, we'll show you the 6-year in a second. So this is just an example. So whenever we have an opportunity to replace a good size of equipment, we're going to really address the entire building or the entire section. So for example, the high school will be up for renewal for the boilers, because when we did the renovation at the high school, none of the equipment was replaced. So the boilers go back to the 60s right now. They work great, they're cast iron, but the goal is to really move towards the net zero and more energy efficient. So as we get to that year when we have to address that boiler or those three boilers, then that's when we do the full study on the whole school and address it as one project. So that's why our 10-year as promised, and that was actually recommended by the net zero study, that the town, the public facilities will come up with a 10-year plan, and that's our goal, is by early spring of next year, we'll have the plan presented to both the school committee as well as the selectmen. Oh, that was quick. So, thank you.
The curbside composting and the opt-up for the community choice aggregation. So please stop over and grab some of that information or how you can get involved in the organization as well. And our next meeting is going to be on Monday, November 18th at 6:45. Grab one of our cards and we can send you the information as to where that is. Michael, you want to talk a bit about the ESC and what's coming up next for you?
Thank you. As it says up there, our next meeting is going to be Thursday, November 14th at 7 p.m. here. You can get more information on the town website about the Energy and Sustainability Committee. We currently have an opening. If any town members are interested in joining, please let us know. And then you can find more information. You can email us at esc@bedford.gov.
We all came here for a reason tonight, and it was either our concerns or our fears or just lack of information. But what I think pulls us all together is the hope that we've been able to see in that we can actually mitigate some of this climate change concern before time is running out. We are actually making some progress, and we can do that together. So thank you for your support. Have a great night.
Thank you.